simplification again, because it can true, it actually relates.
I'm trying to block.
Are we good?
Oh. Yeah.
Okay. So I have used this method of trying to manage conflict, so to speak, for the past 20 plus years of ministry. And it is what I believe can help the church move out of the basement and up more toward the main floors and the higher elevations. So it's called triangulation. Are you familiar with that language? Okay, so a triangle, an emotional triangle, is something that gets formed when one person gets in the middle of an issue going on between two other people. Okay? Sometimes we form triangles.
That was mother-in-law.
Mother-in-laws are good. Actually, I have a great story about a triangulation.
Sorry.
Related to mother-in-laws.
No, I back off too. She's alone.
Did you all, do you watch the show Everybody Loves Raymond?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So the mother and father are Frank and Marie.
Yep.
And they live across the street. And the reason this show is so funny, because it's a movie about triangulation, right? Or a show about triangulation, because people are always getting in the middle of each other's stuff. Well, Frank and Marie are having marital problems, and separately come across the street to talk to Raymond about their marital problems, right? So at one point, Marie is across the street talking to Raymond about their marital problem, and he says, I don't want to be in the middle of this. Right? I don't want to be in this emotional triangle. And Marie says, that's good. I don't want you in the middle. I want you on my side. You hear what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't want you in the middle. I want you on my side. And now, when sides develop in church life, you're in trouble. Right? Or the conflict. Peter Stanky, who's an expert on church conflict, says that every conflict needs a generator and an amplifier. And oddly, we sometimes amplify conflict by triangulation. And the way you really get into triangulation is by talking about people, not to people, when you have a problem with them. It's pretty simple. So if you have a problem with somebody, you go to them directly and you talk to them about that problem. So what Raymond actually should have said to his parents is, you guys need to talk to each other about this, right? And then back off. So my first experience with triangulation, I was a residence hall director at a college dorm. So kind of like dorm parents. So my wife and I were dorm parents in this college dorm. And we had what were called RAs who worked underneath us. So they were the floor supervisors. And this was a Christian college, and so they had, there were rules like no alcohol on campus. So kids, students would drink alcohol off campus, but they weren't allowed to bring it onto campus and have it in their rooms. And if they got caught with it in their room, they had to get written up, kind of thing. So, and a lot of colleges now, because of the drinking age, have similar policies or they, whatever. So there's all different reasons. But our policy was no alcohol on campus. Well, at one point, this student brought a six-pack onto campus, and her RA saw it, wrote her up, came down into my office. She was in tears. Because it's hard to do. And actually, confrontation was one of the skills they learned in their work that I was glad to enable them to learn. Great skill to have, to be able to confront them. So anyway, she wrote it up, she sends it to the dean. The dean gets the write-up, calls this girl into his office, realizes this is a good kid who didn't usually do things that were against school policy, slaps her on the wrist. No punishment whatsoever. Sends a letter back to her saying that there was really no punishment, don't do it again. This girl takes the slap on the wrist letter, puts it on her door, and goes, na 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 na, right? The RA who got nananananananan, comes down to my office in tears again and says, I can't believe the dean didn't back me up on this. And I said, you need to go and talk to him about this. It would be good for him to hear how this made you feel, right? She said, that's a great idea, I will do that. And I'm like, this is perfect. Then later that day, I'm walking through the middle of campus, and who do I see?
The dean.
The dean. So, what do I do? Huh? I should have done nothing.
You go the other way.
I should have done nothing. It was set up for perfect resolution. But what I did was I went to the dean and I gave him a heads up. Because I wanted to be helpful. I wanted to help him to know the hard conversation he was going to enter into later on that day. And you know what he said to me? He goes, I can't believe she didn't come to me to talk about this. Oh. And in hindsight, as I've psychoanalyzed myself to death on this one issue, I realized I wasn't trying to be helpful. I was trying to appear helpful to my boss. I wanted him to think I was helpful. Right? What it did was it threatened his relationship with her and her relationship with him. And had I stayed out of the middle of it, it would have resolved itself fine. He was a big boy, and he could have handled that conversation, even if it surprised him. Okay. Fast forward to, I'm in my first year in Attleboro at the church I'm at. One really weird thing about serving a church for 15 years and then going to another church is they do things differently than you were doing. And even though you know you shouldn't introduce too much change all at once, it's just really hard not to introduce some change. And so you sort of bring yourself into the position. Well, slowly but surely, we made some decisions, some together, some on my own, whatever. And in general, everybody was going with the flow. This one woman who had been kind of out of things for a bit because her daughter was in the hospital, ended up coming a few months later and saw all this change, and she freaked out. And it was weird because she was younger. She seemed like she was somebody who would be go with the flow, even like change, but she didn't like the change. She goes to my associate pastor's office and sits down with him and lays it all out. I can't believe we're changing, blah, 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 blah. You know, she shares all this stuff with him. You know, we had already talked, I already coached him on triangulation. He says, you should go talk to Doug. I know he's big, but he's not that scary. You know what I mean? So he sets it up. She says, that's a good idea. And she left. I was down in the office. He was down the hall in his office. He comes down to me, and guess what he does?
Heads up.
Huh?
Give you a heads up?
Yeah, he's giving me a heads up. He's trying to be helpful. He's trying to help me. He tells me about her anxiety and how upset she was. I didn't sleep for 2 nights. It was awful. I was all worried. She never came to talk to me.
Oh.
So then I went back to my associate pastor's office, and I'm like, never do that to me again. I go, I even slept for 2 nights, and she didn't even need to do anything but just get it off her chest. She just needed to share and vent a little bit with him. And had he not completed the triangle, we would have been fine. Another example of this is like, if somebody comes up to me and says, hey, Pastor Bill and Sally are having marriage problems. Would you go talk to them? I'm like, are you kidding me? What I say to people who do that to me is I go, how about you go back to Bill and Sally and encourage them to come and talk to me? Because if they come and talk to me, it's totally different than me knocking on their door. So if I knock on their door and I say, hey, I hear you guys are having marriage problems. And they're like, what? Who told you that? Well, it was Billy. Well, but now all of a sudden there's a triangle with Billy, there's a triangle with me, and what happens is triangles start to overlap. And what seem like small issues all of a sudden can become huge issues over time.
Can you say something about where there's communication and the communication is becoming traumatic for a person on one end of it? Is it okay if you're encouraging people to leave communication between themselves? If one person shuts down communication because it's too dangerous for them or they don't want to receive it, is that a form of resolution of what's going on between those two people? You know, like, I mean...
Well, I think, like, I've had people, you know, inevitably, you know, somebody's going to leave your church someday because of you, right? They're just going to be upset and they're going to leave. And the best thing you can do is call them up and say, hey, can I meet with you? And if they say no, that's a conflict that has been generated, but it's not amplified. If the church takes that conflict and runs with it and develops sides, then we're in trouble, right? Some of the worst conflict things that I've been involved with, one, I was working with this pastor, associate pastor, whose senior pastor was threatened by him. Like, the senior pastor thought the associate pastor wanted his job. And nothing could have been further from the truth. He was a gifted guy, right? But this guy saw this guy talking to church members and sort of developing a side. So what does he do?
The same thing.
He gets his people and they...
So we had a great reality show.
I don't know if you've noticed, there are some reality shows with ministers. It's crazy, but what happens is when you, the best thing you can do if you see a side developing and somebody misbehaving badly by generating that side is let them go swim in their side. It'll fade out if you don't amplify it, but the minute you start talking to somebody else, the generating your side is the, you're just writing your papers. Like, here, I want to leave this church. Can I go now? You know, it's crazy how this stuff can just feed into the system. I had one really complicated relationship with this person in my church who left the church. And she was upset with me. She had two sisters in the church who were active, committed members of the church. And I was like, oh, this is going to be complicated. But what I did was I just kept the conflict between their sister and me. And I come to find out they weren't surprised at all that she left. She left every pastor.
Yeah.
You know, she had some issue that kept her from being able to be in a relationship with the pastor. And so when I came to that church, she was the most supportive voice there. I was like, well, this is the nicest. She said so many nice things about me. And I was scared of her sisters. Because one of the sisters was a kitchen lady, like she was in charge of the kitchen. She's scared. She's probably like, after 15 years of ministry, she's probably my closest friend out of a bunch. She was amazing, but she scared the daylights out of me when I started. I don't know, that was weird. But what was cool was if I kept the conflict between me and her and I didn't talk about her to other people, it maintained my relationship with them.
Yeah.
So then I want to ask or highlight two things then. So one would be that, for instance, the surge team is committed to helping with transition. So now it's a transitional team.
Mm-hmm.
In a lot of churches, pastor-parish relations or transition teams receive feedback and then pass it to the pastor.
Yeah, that's awful.
Okay, so if we're talking about this transparency of communication model, can you say we shouldn't be pursuing that form?
So pastoral relations committees function if they do one thing, and that is if they speak honestly to the pastor from their own perspective. In other words, I don't like the hymns you're picking. Like, can you pick something we actually know? Or, you know, something like that. But not, you know, three people have come up to me and told me that they don't like the hymns you're picking. And what we're doing is triangulating. I call, a lot of pastoral relations committees are hotbeds for triangulation. And they breed them. And they keep you down in the basement, lock, stock, and barrel. And they're the worst things you can... I think it's way better not to have them if you can't do it right. You can do it right if you give honest feedback about what's going on with the ministries as a whole. But if you're taking information from outside sources, other people, and bringing it to the meeting, you're in trouble.
So the transition team, if they get feedback, needs to encourage people to come to whoever's feeling directly affected by it.
Exactly.
Either that person listens compassionately and nothing more happens because the person's been heard.
Yeah.
And or they're supposed to come talk to me or the music minister or whoever might be sort of impacting what's going on.
Yeah, and somebody might be upset with Gail, right? So somebody's upset with Gail and they come to you as a leader in the church and they're like, I don't like that Gail had a party on Mardi Gras. That was weird.
You should go talk to Gail for hours.
Yeah, go talk to Gail. I can't go talk to Gail. I'm scared.
Well, then, actually,
she
doesn't
really
know how you feel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Preschool.
Yeah. Right. So, what I want to say is the next thing, yeah, and that's right. That's what you need
that's
to do.
Exactly.
And here's how you can do it. You can say, hey, I know she's kind of scary, so how about I'll go with you to talk to Gail and be a part of it. Now, the part of it you're going to be is you're just going to sit there and do your needlepoint while they talk.
Yeah. Yeah.
And on occasion, if there's no volume in the room, you just go, so Gail, what do you think about that?
Yeah. Yeah.
And you facilitate the conversation. I had a music director. She was, oh, man, she was a lot of work. Anyway, she liked to make people mad. I mean, that's just what she did, right? So I get to this church, and I knew it. I knew it the minute I met her. I'm like, oh. And anyway, so she just was a strong personality and liked mess. She just liked it. She liked picking songs people didn't like to sing. Anyway, so anyway, one day, she was also our junior choir director, and she's leading the junior choir, and she has tryouts for solos, right? And I saw the sign, and I just went, what? And I'm like, or maybe it said auditions, I don't remember, it was one of the two words. And I just was like, okay. So, of course, the next week, I get a call in my office, the parent is really upset, their daughter didn't get a solo. And I'm like, okay. So she comes in. I'm even thinking, yeah, that wasn't appropriate. Or it just didn't feel right with this age group or whatever. So I said, would you feel comfortable having a conversation with her with me there? And she said, yeah, that actually would be great. So I set up the meeting with the choir director. We all sit down on the couch together. I didn't say a single word. I didn't have to say anything. So the choir director said, actually, anybody who tries out for a solo in our church gets a solo. Just maybe not right at that moment, but they'll get one. And the mom shared why she was upset and it resolved. I had one family that left my first church, and I called them up on the phone. And I thought what I was doing was, a lot of people were asking me, well, what happened to the Smiths? I'm making up that name. So I said, I don't know. They decided to like the new flavor down the street or whatever. So I was like, I need to close the door. And I had heard a rumor they were going to this other church. So I call them up on the phone and I said, hey, I just heard, or I haven't seen you guys in a while and I have a sense, you know, maybe you're moving on or whatever. I just wanted to check in with them. And they said, oh, you know what, we'd really like to come back. Is it okay if we come back? Yeah. Yeah, you can come back. And I was like, wow, I could have spent a lot of time talking about them and how silly their decision was to go to this other church. But instead, I called them directly, had a direct conversation with them, and they said, could we come back? That's all I need.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
You know, it's part of the search committee. I'm now on the transition team. And one of the things that we've communicated to Gail that we've heard from church members is the song at the end of the service, the benediction song. Yeah. And you know, we had a lot of people saying they'd like to get returned to a song we had before, and we communicated that to Gail graciously. Did we now set up a channel of communication so that they won't go to her? You know, come to us with their gripes instead?
Well, I think anybody who still feels that way, you could present it to Gail, right?
Yeah.
Gail could also get to a point where she wants to say, well, if the whole congregation feels that way, maybe we can vote on it. I mean, that's a potentially controversial thing.
I mean, she did it. It's fine. So, you know, we're doing that now. We're doing what everybody requested.
Yeah.
So the danger
zone is when you start to communicate for people, or people feel like they can come to you instead.
And that's where you
get into huge, huge problems. A friend of mine who is a member of my church, but an associate member of another church where she lives closer to the water now, she became the pastoral relations committee chair for a new pastor who came in, who was a UCC church too. And she was the lightning rod of everybody's angst. And she felt like her job was to take their angst and share it with the pastor. She almost left the church. And this is one of these, like, you never want to make this kind of person mad.
I mean, for years, Sam, you were in the trenches with me on Pastor Petch for a while. I found that incredibly frustrating.
Yeah.
Because people came to you with their problems, expecting you to resolve their problems with the pastor. And the other way around. So we were just a sponge at one point. Stuff was coming in both sides, and I felt like, I'm getting pretty full here. And I felt like oftentimes we were never able to resolve a situation, we were just able to identify it, which are two very different things.
Absolutely.
And I was like, this isn't my water I'm carrying here.
Yeah.
So I felt like this is, aside from the thing that we did, I thought that was good, was we did an annual review, which I thought was a good process, and you were part of that too. But I would get calls and people would stop me, and I have a problem with the color shoelaces, or it was minutiae and big things.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's where those committees were hot for this.
But I remember when we first invented having Pastor Parrish, I think Bob Navarro was still here. And it was to be his soundboard.
Yeah.
It was a very quiet committee. He had a few people that he kind of chose, and, you know, Don Graves and a couple other people that he really trusted. And it didn't come to the congregation as, oh, these are the guys to go complain to. It was purely his sounding board, and that worked well when it was that original intent.
I find it, and I wrote about this in my book, I find it interesting that my roles as parent, and I also volunteer coach soccer and basketball for kids while my kids were grown, that I've never been a part of another institution where people feel such freedom to complain. And as a matter of fact, a lot of leaders in churches think it's their role to give people avenues to complain. Now, when I'm a parent, I often tell my kids, quit griping.
Suck it up.
My favorite song to sing to them when they were children was, you can't always get what you want.
I think I sang that the other day.
Yeah, it's a great song to sing to kids, right?
You get what you need.
You get what you need, you know? Sorry, I don't mean to sing it. It's scary. But also coaching soccer, like, your big job was just keep telling people to stop complaining, you know?
So one of the things that it's been helpful to me that you said, and I just want everybody to hear this, is that if we start down a path, like, okay, we started receiving critiques about worship or something like that, but maybe in a way that it potentially creates that model that we're trying to now avoid of triangulation. Yeah. You can just sort of stop it by saying, look, you know, we took this workshop with Doug, and you know what? What we learned was to be a healthy communicating church. If you have a thought about worship, talk to whoever, you know, is like part of the worship, come to me directly, so redirect the communication, right? So that's kind of what you're saying. But you can start that at any point. We just want to start that earlier rather than later.
Yeah, I do a... So at our annual meeting in January, it's like the second, third week in January, we elect all of our officers and we approve our budget and do all that stuff and give reports. Then the next week, I do what I call the leadership orientation meeting. And I do it, I've done it once a year for 20 years. And every year, I do a lot of different types of things at that meeting. But one thing I cover every year is triangulation. And I say, this is what it is, this is how we avoid it. And when new people are coming on, they're really grateful to know about it because they're like, oh, that's important. So I have a guy, he was a medical doctor, just retired, tremendously gifted, bright guy, who just became chair of our deacons. And so I'm in a bigger church now. So the model that we were supposed to live into at my small church was multiple boards and chair and the church council at the top is how we function now. So I actually have boards now. So you might hear me being anti-board. I think the multiple board system under a top level executive board, as long as they're the governing body above me when they're all together. So I have one group of people in the church who are above me authoritatively. That works. The other boards are ministry teams that implement things. So anyway, this fellow became our deacon chair. He hadn't been in church leadership since when he started medical school, like 35 years prior. So the church had changed a lot in terms of the way we function and so forth. But he's coming on as chair of the deacon board, and he knew he was going to be involved with worship life and stuff. And his wife likes to, she's a fixer, like she likes to fix things and work on things with the choir director. So he was getting it from her already. Like, well, you got to make sure you do this and fix this and blah, blah, blah. And when I described triangulation, he left the room and he went, thank goodness. Like, I can tell my wife to go talk to the person she needs to talk to instead of, like, she was already, and there's nothing wrong with talking to somebody about a concern yet. Where the problem comes is when you complete the triangle. So this is key for your key leaders in the system, and especially for your pastor. Like, don't complete the triangles. And encourage people to talk to each other, not about each other.
Is there ever a time where there's conflict between two people and it can't be resolved that somebody needs to be a mediator?
I think you can offer mediation services, and if they don't accept that, then that's the end of that.
Yeah, I've been amazed how much conflict we can resolve just by having those difficult discussions. See, the problem is we get anxious about what we have to share. One way, if somebody comes up to you and complains about something and you agree with them, you can take that issue and go from your own concern. I'm concerned about the closing song we sing after the benediction. Can we talk about that? That's different than, hey, five people have come to told me that they don't like this. Why don't you change it? That's a totally different thing. So you can hear a concern from somebody else, and if you share the concern, go on your own volition and share it directly. That's different than five people told me this, I want to tell you that. You know, because then when I got to my church, now they had a review process where they actually did it by triangulation. They would go out and get three people to review you anonymously and write it up and then give it to you. So you couldn't even get feedback.
Oh.
It was the messiest thing I'd ever seen.
Let's do that.
And it blew up in our face. It blew up so big time. I almost lost our new choir director, who's awesome. Like, it would have been a disaster.
We did the same thing in variation for years.
Yeah.
Where we would give annual feedback. Everybody in the church got feedback. And it was just a license to kill.
It's bad. It's a bad way to do it. And here, so we rewrote our whole way of doing review process, so that it included self-reviews from the staff people. It includes, it's just lower key in terms of what gets brought out, but also gave specific, she told me she was leaving, but she's not mad.
Have you talked this over?
But the best thing we did was an overall ministry review where you look at the whole church and how it's functioning. And my choir director, my associate pastor, and I sit with the board, and the board gives us feedback about how we're doing in worship, how we're doing in fellowship, how we're doing in education or discipleship, and how we're doing in outreach.
Which has got to be their opinion and not necessarily the opinion of the...
Right, they're just sharing their thoughts that they came up with as a group with us. And then we interact with, well, you know, I'll give you, they said, we're not doing much for young adults. And young adults are, you know, I'm like, you know, we're doing everything for youth, we're doing children, we're doing, you know. Sometimes it would just sit there for 2 or 3 years, but then all of a sudden something starts to happen in that area they talked about. I've seen more concrete good ideas come out of that review process than anything I've ever done in the church. And it's just inviting lay leaders to honestly share about how they think that things are going. And what we realized was, hey, they're not just critiquing us as staff, but themselves as members. That we're looking at the whole picture together and sharing thoughts. And so some of the resolutions of some of the problems hasn't been us as staff members, but it's been the lay people saying, well, we could try this, or we could do that, or we could, you know.
I have two more questions. One is, so that practice that we're talking about within the church is also one that's healthy for anybody at any point. So when somebody comes to you and complains about another person, suggesting to them to redirect their concerns directly to that person then basically eliminates you from being the middle person in a triangle anywhere, anytime, and maintains that healthy communication. One gray area for me is people are aware of a sensitive situation happening, like somebody's a vulnerable person in our community, and they want me to know about it. People can come and tell me about a sensitive situation as long as I don't immediately jump up and act on it and create some triangulation. If it allows it to be on my radar screen, so if a person, if I can then observe something and go directly to a person in a way that's organic.
Yeah. Like
I meet somebody out in the shop and I just say, hey, tell me what's going on, right? I might have in the back of my mind that there might be something brewing for that person, but I don't act on information that I immediately go say, hey, so-and-so told
that's
me
right.
that you were upset,
that's right.
you're in trouble, and blah, blah, blah. So it's okay to share concerns with the minister
yes.
or the team as long as I don't breach confidentiality and I don't become a triangulating person.
Yeah, and also you don't need to report back to the person who brought the concern to you.
Yeah.
So that would be completing the triangle. Right. Also going to that, so that couple I was talking about earlier that's having marital problems, so they say, will you go talk to them? And I say, no, but you can recommend that they talk to me. But then later I see Bill at the diner. I said, hey Bill, how are you? Good to see you. I haven't seen Sally in a while.
Yeah.
What's going on? And then it might open the door to conversation. So then, that's what I mean. So going to your pastor to share with her what your concern is doesn't mean she needs to act on it right away or ever say that they told you that in the first place. So that's partly the art of avoiding triangulation.
I just want to make sure that people are clear that it's okay to tell me about things because that may be
that's right absolutely
other people are aware of information I'm never going to have
that is an excellent we had this sort of burgeoning slightly growing Jackson neighbor care program and this is invited Gail to come to this meeting and the safety committee because it's ambulance fire and just sort of heads up around the community who might need help but it's a classic example of And I got some, this person couldn't get out. We're like, hey, let me just drive by. And so you have that organic aspect.
Yeah.
But then for us to really say, hey, how are things going? Gail, great new pastor. You can talk to her at any time.
Yeah.
And these are your hours, right? That would be an appropriate way to sort of see if they, and if they take that initiative, we give you the heads up and then you kind of. What happens.
I just don't want it to. I don't want people to think that.
Oh, clearly.
Because that closing that door would shut me away from it.
Yeah. But what was amazing to me, I did this. I was at an in a South Side of Chicago African American Pastors Conference. I'm telling the same thing to these guys. And they're like, oh my gosh. Do you know how much time and energy I spend getting in the middle of people's stuff? And here I am, I'm trying to help and I'm actually hurting it. Mm-hmm. And here I was giving them permission to back off, mm-hmm. not be in the middle of all the stuff, and that you're actually helping by not being in the middle of the stuff. Mm-hmm. And let those people who want help come to you when they need help. Yeah. And then you actually end up doing better ministry, mm-hmm. right? A lot of times we go to our pastor when we feel like this is beyond me. Like, okay, they just told me about these problems and it's beyond me here. It's all yours, right? That's okay. That's okay, and that's what I think Gail's saying, is I want people to feel free to do that, and that's fine. Just know that she can't, and actually, I think you want to go like this. Here, you take it. Don't tell them I told you. But then if you go to them and you tell them, oh, I heard from Billy, then you just triangle the whole thing, and it's a mess.
I think that part of what I felt in this parish for a very long time, in this congregation, is that we tend to be so New Englandish and private and not say anything.
Yeah.
That we have people who don't come 6 months, a year, 2 years, and you don't even dare say in the grocery store, gee, I haven't seen you in a while, because it's, you're offending my, you're getting into my space. So we have people just drift off, and we have a list of, 59 people that we don't even know where they are or what they are, whether they died, whether they moved someplace else, whether they went to another church, or they moved to Florida, because we don't, nobody's done anything. So I sometimes feel like people might be out there being lonesome, or feel like the church doesn't care, because whatever's been going on in my life, I haven't shown up for 6 months, but it'd be really nice if somebody said hi.
Just like the couple that came back that you talked to again.
Yeah.
But I feel like we've been guilty of that for years and years and years. The private, don't ask them why they're not
here. That Yankee mentality.
Oh, yeah. And
but I do think my wife has this. She was from the Midwest, so she's from Chicago.
Well, they're so nice.
Yeah, but you know what? This is her analogy, that Midwesterners are like peaches and East Coasters are like oranges. No, the Midwest, they're fuzzy and soft on the outside, but hard as heck. Hard to get to know. East Coast people, they're hard on the outside, like they're hard to get to know at first, but once you do, you're in. Right? She says her best friends have been on the East Coast. And yet, when you meet them at first, you're like, wow, they are the rudest people I've ever met. I do this thing on the fruit of the spirit, right? And one of people's most desirable fruits is joy. We all want to experience it. But I'm like, man, in New England, there's no such thing as fake fruit, you know? Nobody pretends to be joyful. In the Midwest, a lot of people are miserable, but they pretend they're happy. On the East Coast, they're quite comfortable being miserable. That's awesome. And that's why I love pastoring on the East Coast. I like that reality, you know?
Because fake fruit's no fun. Story only from Southerners.
Exactly.
They welcome you and they smile and offer all this.
My brother lived down south and he's like, man, bless your heart can mean just about anything. Bless your heart, man. It means I'm not talking to you ever again. You know, well, bless your heart. Bless your heart. You know, it means go to hell.
So now we get all these people moving from all different places in the country here.
Yeah.
What are the fruit cells?
it's interesting. But I think it's beautiful. I mean, I think there's richness in all that diversity of ways of processing and dealing with things. But it also raises the ante on doing this well, right? Because, I mean, there's nothing like somebody who's impressed by how well this seems to work, you know? It gives opportunity for people to thrive here. And again, I think you're the only gig in town. When you come into this town, this is the church people see. And And it just seems like you're so connected to the community in a lot of different ways that that's the thing to capitalize on. Like, let that just well up, you know? So that, I remember one time somebody asked me, what's your church known for? What is your church known for? How would you respond?
I say that people come to Jackson Church for three reasons.
Yeah.
Because we're the Jackson Community Church.
Yeah.
Some people come because it's Jackson.
Yeah.
Those are fewer.
Yeah.
Some people come for the community.
Yeah.
And some people come because it's church.
Yeah.
Some people come to get married.
Yeah. It used to be a lot more of that. But our original name, and I think this helps and hurts us. I mean, the original name of this church was Free Will Baptist Church.
Wow.
Yeah.
Before we were Jackson Community Church. And free will says a lot of things. He's like, yeah, I'm not going to come.
Yeah.
That's my free will. Or,
yeah,
you know, I'm going to...
It's sort of like live free or die.
Yeah.
Yep.
I wanted to make bumper stickers for New Hampshire that say die free and live. That's all another theological debate. But no, so I just think there's... When I'm here, like, I'm like, this place screams with potential.
Yeah.
And I think you're tapping into it on some level already. Like that, the level of connectedness I'm sensing is great. I think there's more potential for it. I think the Mardi Gras event showed it.
That was real evidence.
Yeah.
Okay.
That if you, see the beauty is if you function well together, even if you're a small body, it's kind of nice to be a part of that.
Well, we gotta just throw it out there, do some of those things.
We are.
I was saying,
I mean, that's exactly it. And people, ooh, I didn't hear about this.
But if you're so tired just keeping up with your system that's complicated and hard to keep up with, you're too tired to do any fun stuff. Mm-hmm. There's so many little, but this is what I was reflecting on last night when we had dinner together, was that I just was so struck driving into town by the simplicity of the building. How it looked from, you know, the corner of Main Street. And then going in the sanctuary, I'm like, beautiful simplicity. And then I come in here, functional simplicity. This is a great room. So everything's kind of simple.
On the surface.
Yeah. and
complexity.
Yeah, and the everything except one thing. And that's the system. And again, that, and I call it the church monster because overly complicated church systems, again, have been developed because of mistrust. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to keep any decisions from getting made. And so we spend a lot of time and energy trying to keep those decisions from being made. Whereas if you make them congregationally, it just simplifies the whole deal. And allows you to function in a simplified way. So that, you know, you don't need parking lot conversations about what's going on in the life of the church. When you go out into the parking lot after worship, instead you talk to each other about, how are your kids doing in college? You know? Oh, I was really sorry to hear about your mom passing away. Isn't that the stuff we should be talking about in the church parking lot? Instead of, can you believe nobody made coffee for coffee art today? Or whatever the deal was today. Right? I mean, that's... So what I'm suggesting is simplify your church system so that you spend less of this block on administration and decision making and more of it creating fun programs, developing good relationships, deepening your faith in God, the things that of the why the church exists in the first place.
So can I just ask you to talk about the congregational meetings?
Yeah.
And I'm just really curious, like, so what's the schedule?
So we have a quarterly congregational meeting. You don't need to do it right now,
saying,
you just
I'm
do the annuals.
Like quarterly. And you have like your monthly. I'm not.
Do you just do annual right now?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So I would say do.
Spring and fall.
Yeah, yes. Maybe in addition, three at the
like
most.
Like a late October or.
Yeah.
April.
And if we have, and if, but if something comes up, we can.
You have a special meeting.
Can we post it and all that, the official stuff?
Yeah, rarely.
Like Martin Luther.
I'll tell you, rarely, rarely do we have special meetings with the quarterly system in now. I think my small church in Connecticut, at most, would have three.
Okay.
Yeah, and you figure out what you need. It might be you just need a fall and your annual meeting and that's it.
Yeah, I was just saying, you weren't meeting monthly as a congregation.
No, and these bigger decisions that need congregational approval generally are things that are happening over an extended period of time. So you don't need meetings. It's not about having more meetings. And somebody said, well, aren't you going to have a lot of stupid stuff come up because you want your thing to come? I'm like, no, the silly stuff disappears. Because nobody wants their silly issue to end up in front of the whole party.
Well, then you said, like, a money limit? Like, okay.
That
congregational could, meetings for anything over $5,000.
Yeah. And it could be lower than that.
Yeah.
Like, it's that's
whatever that is.
Your council should discern what's the threshold.
Yeah.
But sometimes something doesn't cost a lot of money, but it is a big change.
Yeah.
So you would that's why I said we just use the thumb discernment of, is this potentially controversial? And if we discerned that it was, we would bring it to the congregation. The other thing is when you have congregational meetings, in here there's one piece on Robert's rules or whatever. Yeah, see, people hate Robert's rules, but I love them. So, but I read this book that was really helpful to me, Canon's Concise Guide to Rules of Order, and it's one of the chapters in the Monster book. But his philosophy was, you use Robert's rules as much as necessary, but as little as possible. And he transformed, when the Democratic National Convention blew up in the 60s in Chicago, he was the one they called in to fix it. So that's a huge meeting, right? So a big meeting needs a lot of Robert's rules. But what he's saying is you need to use them as little as possible, but as much as necessary. I think the key concept is have a motion before you have discussion. So we want to put brown carpet in the fellowship hall. And this is the simple. Our motion is that the church approve it so we can buy it. Okay, all in, you know, is there any discussion?
Somebody seconds it and then.
Yeah, but shouldn't we do something more colorful? No, it's going to get used a lot. It's dirt and all that. Okay, call a question. All in favor of brown carpet in the fellowship hall? Raise your hand.
In other words, it can be very short and efficient meetings too.
Yeah, one of the most stunning ones that I did at my current church. So we had, Jay was our associate pastor when I first got there. When he told the church he was leaving, everybody was sad. And there was a general universal sense that we were going to start a search committee. And it was already in our budget, so it wasn't like we needed to change the budget. And I said to the church council chairperson at the time, I said, I still want to reaffirm the position congregationally. And we need to have a meeting to vote on the search committee anyway. So we put the search committee together, called a meeting, presented the motion to reapprove the position to keep it in our budget. Unanimous vote. Presented the search committee, unanimous vote. It took 5 minutes. And after we all just stood in a big circle in prayer, this was awesome. So we're all standing in a big circle, realizing that we just bought ourselves like an hour of fellowship. And this little girl walks through the doors and is looking at this big circle. And I'm like, Heather, would you join hands with us? And I'm like, she's the reason we just did this. Boom. I mean, it was a boom. And then 2 years later, when we're having financial trouble, we voted to reaffirm our commitment to the position so people get behind it. So it seemed silly almost at the time. 2 years later, I was really glad we made that decision together, not me making it alone.
One of the challenges that we have is our old structure hampers, I think, a new meeting environment, in the sense that this has happened every year that I can remember in the last however many years at our annual meeting. We're literally calling people to get more.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So by this document, you know, we need a one-fourth quorum for any meeting. And that, we re-voted that a few years ago down from a third. So we used to have a third people. We used to sit here and wait for somebody to put their kids to bed or get home for dinner.
Yeah.
And with a transient population, it can be very hard to achieve the necessary body to make the decision. That's a practical thing, that either we need to change this again, or we need to get rid of what the number one thing we need to do is get rid of our ghost members who make our quorum so high that we can't achieve it.
Both are probably good.
Is it a percentage?
Yeah. So one quarter of the membership.
Of the active membership.
So that for us is like 42 people.
It's a lot of people because we have so many like
ghosts
that are on our roster.
Some of them are probably
literally. So what I would run is a percentage off your average attendance from the previous year.
I would say we need to get, the one thing we should do again is revisit the quorum rule for the bylaws, just to make it fair to the population.
How many people do show up at your annual meeting?
About 40.
30, 40.
That's a pretty amazing number, I think, from a congregation.
Really, and it's January when it's cold and the weather.
And we had to call in two people this year.
Somebody has to pick
That's awesome. I love that.
It seems like there's always one or two.
I remember there's one year I would come and vote and leave really quickly, and Kaylee would come down and vote.
You would watch the kids.
That's lovely. That's great stuff.
I love that meeting piece, but we need to think about our structural piece to make it more.
I see what you're saying. Like, we would have to revisit that sooner rather than later, so that if we're going to operate with.
I think in the sense of duality, we need to think about revising this.
What's the number in your heart that you think would be a reasonable quorum?
30. I mean, if you're gonna do it like on a Sunday and just do it like right
60%
after
60% of your average.
Yeah, so 25, you know, you could even go with a number, but the percentage is a safety net in case you shrink or whatever. But I would say do you keep attendance?
I don't think
no.
I
do. We do not.
I would make it very simple. Members present and active. I mean,
But what defines an active and an inactive?
Well, we have that
bylaw. We do have that.
Okay.
Yeah. Anybody that shows up at church is automatically active.
So, but is somebody who's not showing up and not giving counted?
There's a giving aspect to it.
Yeah.
There's every 2 years, though, of not doing anything.
Okay,
and
that's fine.
And then you have to notice he didn't show up.
Right.
Yeah. He showed up at Christmas Eve 1 year.
That's the kind of minutia that you guys need to work out yourselves. Yeah. You know what I mean? And I said to Gail, I'm open. She can call me anytime she wants. And Bob, as moderator, anytime you guys want to call me and consult about anything going on, I'm glad to talk to you on the phone. Like, just if you need some coaching, feel free to call me anytime. I don't mind.
What happens if you put a time restriction so it gives us the opportunity, like the quorum required? So that there is an opportunity for us to change it if it needs to be changed, like every 3 years.
Yeah.
In parentheses, every 3 years.
Yeah.
You make your suggestion, you vote on it.
Yeah.
But
and I would be gracious to yourselves. But what you don't want to do is make it so small that it's not represented.
All right.
And the other thing is to give yourself some policy. Most churches have a constitution and bylaws, and the bylaws might state they're a little less serious and easier to change. But you could do those so that, for example, you say, if a major decision is being presented at a congregational meeting, you need to give people a week's notice.
That's an advantage.
That
posted like Mark Luther literally on the door.
But I feel very strongly that if people don't come to the meeting and decisions are made, you should have been at the meeting.
And you know what? But
I think we should also say if there are people, you know, it's a scary dark night, we will provide rides to help people get there. you know, that's, why can't you, yeah.
And keeping it simple and doing it after church on Sunday or whatever, you know.
And allowing it by phone if.
No, I think those are, that's too much triangulation. Even email decisions can be kind of, I'm not in favor.
Yeah.
But I think doing it face-to-face, because it's hard to share on the phone a real opinion. The idea of debate, the reason you have a debate about emotion is because people need to hear each other.
There's emotion with.
Yeah, and you can't do that. One thing about congregational decision-making over committees is I always say congregations are more courageous than committees. Because on a committee, what you do is you empower the one naysayer. So we get together and we're planning a worship event and we're going to do something a little different. Oh, but this is really going to upset Mr. Smith. Sorry if anybody's name is Smith, but we better not do it. You know, we empower that one person who's going to get upset to the point that the committee doesn't do anything.
Where you compromise, which is basement.
Right, so then it gets watered down, right? Instead, sometimes if you throw it out to the congregation, they say, yeah, let's not only get that chairlift, but let's get them the better one and spend a little bit more money. You know what I mean? So it's weird. A lot of pastors are really afraid of congregational decision making. They think, I don't want to give up the little power I think I have. Mm-hmm. And then if I give it over to the congregation, they're going to think they're entitled to be a part of everything. And blah, blah, blah. You know, so there's this anxiety you get as the leader, but it's amazing what you get back when your people trust that you're going to bring the toughest decisions to you. It's remarkable. To the point that sometimes I think I have too much power.
And I don't think that's a challenge for us as a community because of our municipal governance structure allows for a lot of people to voice their opinions on a regular basis. At town meeting, they literally change dollar amounts. There's a lot happening, so people are used to standing up and saying no or yes, and here's why.
Yeah.
And I don't think that's a hindrance to us. And I always like to say for every squeaky wheel at most of our meetings, there's some grease.
Yeah.
Which is, we have a lot of back and forth then with body politic besides what the decision is.
Yeah.
But oftentimes minority opinions don't carry the day, which is.
They're loud,
but they don't.
But it's the beauty of this democratic process that we're all used to. And it can be in the church too. A lot of people are negative about it because a lot of times for people who are resistant to congregational decision making, things get ugly before you have a congregational meeting. So they think all congregational meetings are filled with conflict. But the reality is if you give good creative ideas first thing to the congregation, then it can flourish off of the congregation instead of being controversial before you even bring it. So bring it first to them and then let them shoot it down.
How about voting? You know,
mm-hmm.
Everyone's there, you take the vote, everybody says, you know, yay or nay. Do you ever get to a point where, you know, at a town meeting, we're going to
close ballot?
Yeah,
and that just depends on the issue.
So you do, yeah. I mean, it gets.
Sure. And that's the right of the chair to discern
right.
what he or she thinks is the most appropriate way to do this one decision, you know.
Based on the sensitivity of the issue.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would think you kind of.
And one would think that if something was so sensitive that you're down, almost down to a 50-50, that it's probably not something that we have enough consensus on to move forward with.
Well, and again, that depends on the issue,
maybe
too.
By ballot, and then people would really feel free to say what they want to say if they're afraid to.
That's my concern.
Hand up.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're afraid
instead of hands, just like a ballot.
Yeah, yes or no.
And there's a very specific structure in place on a municipal level for that to take place. There's an actual process.
Yeah.
The challenge for us is we don't have a quote-unquote process for that.
And that's why
Roberts has a process.
Yeah, and Roberts Rules of Order gives you, like, again, you got to figure out, I think, so some basics. Motion before discussion. Speak to the chair, not to other members of the church. Are two real basic rules of order. So, and you're speaking in favor or against the motion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was at a denominational annual meeting, and there was some controversial issue that came up, and they were making a decision, and I knew there was somebody who was going to make a motion to eliminate the meat out of a resolution that they had passed. But the, it was a quality motion, it was just sort of a renegade voice that I knew was going to be there. So he went up and made the motion to make an amendment. And I know Robert's rules, even though I'm not a real rulesy kind of guy, but I just went up and I said, I speak against the amendment because the committee that put this together shared a lot of wisdom with us, and I think it's worth approving. Then they called the debate to question. The amendment failed. The motion passed. You know, and it, part of it is just guiding people to speak in the right way at the right time. And it's in favor or against the motion, whatever the motion is. And you're right, if half the room didn't like this color carpet, you might go, why don't we go back to the drawing board? You know, or somebody makes a motion to table it and let you discuss it further. But that's the beauty of the rules. What's not beautiful is when somebody says, you know the Robert's rule guy in the back of the room.
Point of order.
Yeah, point of order, you know, and they go into it and everybody's more confused than they were before. So that gives Robert's rules a bad name because they're trying to use it as much as possible and way more than necessary, right? But if you follow the basic rules, it can really help you to make decisions rather quickly and rather effectively. So then you don't have a two-hour meeting.
So what would be, can you talk to us, I'm a very concrete person a lot of the time. Can you talk to us about time frame? You know, like, if we want to experiment, how long?
It seems to me you're already experimenting, right?
Right.
I mean, and I'm not giving you any legal advice here. No. No, I know, like, when some churches have had constitution and bylaws, they've suspended their bylaws on committees that break it all down to nausea. But that's not touching the constitution. Your constitution's all melded together into one. And you're not doing it anyway, from what I can tell. Like, it's not something, you know, and I'm not saying you should. And a lot of church consultant people say it's good for churches to live outside their constitution for a while. The most important part of your constitution is the first paragraph. You read my mind.
Yeah.
But it's the truth, right? Right. Polity. So polity is another word for church governance. The government of this church is vested in its members who exercise the right to control all its affairs. As a member church of the United Church of Christ, we acknowledge our relationship and obligations to the North County Association and the New Hampshire Conference of Churches in the United Church of Christ. We recognize the relationship of the Jackson Community Church to the Protestant Chapel Association, which was established under the bylaws dated 1847, under the authority of the 144th chapter of Old Hawaii. The rest of that, though, that's the second paragraph. But the government of this church, it's really the first sentence that's the most important. The government of this church is vested in its members who exercise the right to control all its affairs. And basically what that's saying is the congregation is the highest authority. And if you're doing a good job as a church, trusting in that fact, then nobody's going to question how you're making decisions. Conflict in churches develops more often than not by how decisions are made, not what decisions get made. Right? So if a small group of people makes a decision to do something that offends everybody else, you're in trouble. That's where trouble will emerge. You know what I mean? There's a little more authority and a little more freedom if that's a downsized, centralized church government. So you can deal with more sensitive issues and so forth as one body. But I tell you, your moderator will have a happy life if you downsize and centralize into one committee instead of having multiple committees. And I'm not saying those people who, it sounds like your missions committee is semi-functional. Well, your coordinator for the mission committee can be that, a person who has those liaisons and works with them. A lot of what happens in a small church happens because people are used to bearing specific responsibilities. You just kind of do it. I used to joke, I felt like this place, the church I went to at first, could run itself without any structure for a while because everybody was so used to what their responsibilities and duties were. So then it makes you question, do we really need all that much structure? I was struck that you all have an avalanche class going on upstairs. You know, that doesn't happen in most churches. But I was thinking about avalanches and how it's the accumulation of like too much stuff at the top of the hill, and the hill, the structure can't support it. And it causes all this damage and danger, you know? It's kind of like this complicated stuff that we develop structure above our church, and it's like the structure, the people can't contain it. And so I was gonna say nominating committees, yours is defunct because nobody wants to touch it, right? Who wants to be a part of asking people to fill all these different holes when A, you know, you're not keeping up with your bylaws anyway, and B, you know. So here's what happens in churches that are two steps behind you. This is usually when I get called. Is like people are on nominating committees and they call people, kind of like you do to get a few extras at your annual meeting. But they call up and they say, what's your name?
Wendy.
Wendy, could you be on our deacon board for 3 years?
To ask.
No, you're supposed to play the role. Like, what are you going to say?
Oh, sorry, wrong number.
I'll play. No, I was on the nominating committee.
All right, I'll let her do it. Okay. So, would you be on the deacon committee? The deacon board?
Oh, gosh, you know, I'm out of town a lot. So,
like, that's how you
No, you know what? Out. Listen, you don't really have to go to the meetings.
Don't worry, we're body. Are you alive?
Yeah, right. You don't need to go to meetings. You actually don't need to do anything. We just want to keep up with our bylaws, right? This is the conversation that I have every time I meet with
just switch off with someone.
Yeah, we're fine. It's just this thing we have to keep up with. Isn't that bizarre? Right? So here's the deal. This is the real problem, and this is where the church monster comes in, is you just now gave authority with no responsibility.
Right.
It's awful.
And everybody else in the church is going, why aren't the deacons doing their job?
But another committee, they can say, well, I'm already on the deacon's board.
Yeah. So that's what happens. And here's the real problem. There were two books written in the 80s, 90s that were real popular about church conflict. One was called The Well-Intentioned Dragon. And it's that problem person in your church, The Well-Intentioned Dragon. Another book that became really popular is called Clergy Killers. Who are the people killing our clergy, right? They're the problem people in your church. So what this does, right, what both approaches do in those books is they put all the blame on the person, that one person who's the problem person. And I'm sure you got them into your church too, right? That person who gets blamed for all the problems. If only they weren't there. But you know what, if they disappear, somebody else can. But here's the thing, is I think those problem people are people who are hurt. They got pain in their life, and they got pain from a lot of different angles. And ideally, the church would be there for them, not against them, right? So they come into our church kind of broken and in need. They find connection and community that's really healing and helpful. And then they're around a lot, so we decide to have a nominating committee call. And all of a sudden it takes them out of the role of receiving what they need from the church and puts them in the role of having to be responsible. Except, now we've asked them to be only somewhat responsible. And actually just to fill a position. And we've promised them two things. They don't have to go to meetings, and they don't have to do anything.
They have authority.
So they have authority without responsibility. It's a terrible thing to do to your church. It's to take a wounded person who's broken and in need of care. We're all wounded and broken in different ways anyway. But somebody who's non-functional, who doesn't need to be functional because we haven't asked them to be functional, and to put them in leadership is to literally be that person who you're inviting them to put their finger on and stop the stigma at this point. Like, they're going to create problems that are inevitable. And then we write books about them and call them clergy collusion. So that's where the monster comes in. And frankly, it eats those people up. It eats up all the relationships that went into it. It eats up the ministry that could have been good for that person. And it eats away at the fabric of your whole mission as a church. So we have a nominating committee in a church that has more structure, but we have more people, so it actually works. When we call people, we don't tell them they can't do it, that we just need them to fill it. And we never say, you can't be, will you be on this, but you're not going to do it. It's just not a part of the DNA of the church. In my last church, people used to say, well, you only have 10 people in leadership. Isn't it hard to get people to fill those spots? I'm like, somewhat. It's still, you know, you're still asking people to commit. But I go, it's funny, people like committing to something if they feel useful and like they're actually getting something done. And so it becomes an honor to serve on council.
It's a much better way to say to somebody, you know, because you're so involved in music, it seems to me you'd be a great guide for us. Could you be on the music,
yeah.
music coordinator? Right?
Yeah. And you're you know,
acknowledging a talent.
Well, you're acknowledging talent and gift. And this is the way everybody says churches ought to function, is we ought to say, who's really gifted at working with people who would be good at working on the building?
Yeah.
Who's a good leader? You know, it doesn't have to be somebody who's handy necessarily. It could be somebody who just has leadership gifts and has good relationships with guys who drive trucks, you know what I mean, or whatever. Like, who fix things, you know? But when you start looking at who's that's a great place to be, where you're saying, who would be really good in this position? You know? I think you guys have a great pastor. Like, you're in a great spot. I think you have a great chair. I think your moderator is a great person for that role.
You do, yes.
Just from our conversation last night, I'm like, wow, they're in a good spot. Like, I think you have good leaders, and this, you're all great people, and I can tell you're all committed to what's going on here. Or you wouldn't be spending half a day here. You couldn't see.
We've been in positions where you get named this, and yes, you want to help, but then, like membership in church life, sometimes you end up doing it all, because how do you get the other people to realize that just because you're not the person in charge, there is an expectation that we will all, as a congregation, help
right.
with it.
And that's
some people are afraid to take on building and maintenance, are afraid to take on this or that, because they're going to have to do it all because they can't get anybody.
What people love these days is committing to short-term commitments and making a difference. Like, people love volunteering on short-term basis for something that's going to make a difference. So
look at our house cleaning last fall.
Yeah.
And we had 30, 40 people here.
Yeah. That's a one-day gig, right? Yeah. But if their fear is, if I show up, they're going to put me on building and maintenance or whatever.
Yeah.
Right? So people are afraid to dip their toes in the water of responsibility because churches that are overgrown are good at grabbing the leg and pulling you to the deep end. When my roommate from college had graduated and was starting to enter into the real world. He went to Peace Corps first and came back. And so now he's married, had a job, living in the D.C. area, and he was getting involved with this Methodist church. And I'm like, that's great, Jim, glad to hear it. You know, blah, blah, blah. We're talking on the phone. He says, yeah, but this friend of mine, he belongs to another Methodist church down the road. He said, and he was warning me about not getting involved in leadership. I'm like, oh, why? He said, well, because they suck you in, they eat you up and chew you out and spit you out, and then they want to hear your ideas, you share an idea, and it never gets passed, and it's totally frustrating. You're going to end up hating the church. So go to church, be a member of it, just don't get on one of the board. And I'm like, this is great stuff. I'm going to use it. But, it was one young adult talking to another young adult about what not to do in a church. And he was basically saying, don't commit. Yeah. Because they misuse your time. You're going to be totally frustrated by the end. This 60-40 thing or 80-20 thing is going to drive you absolutely bonkers. And so just don't go there. And I'm like, how sad that we're structured in such a way that people feel like they're wasting their time. When we could be structured in a way where we use time effectively and efficiently and in such a way that people feel good about their commitment to the church and feel good about what the church is doing and how it's doing. When you hover in this conflict compromise realm, you can cut it with a knife when you walk into a church. So you wonder, why do people visit and not come back? Mm-hmm. You can feel it. And we get used to it. We think, oh, this isn't the right way to be. It really isn't. This is a much more fun place to be. So the church I'm in hovers here. And we get glimpses of this. Mm-hmm. But this is a fun place to be. Mm-hmm. We don't waste a lot of time. Not that there's no conflict. But we keep it at bay. And we deal with it when it comes up. And
so if we look at our board, our sign-up board over there, right?
Yeah.
As an example, that should be an easy way to get people to just go on one Sunday. And yes, we can struggle from time to time, right, to get people to sign up. Do you have wisdom for us about how you invite people into that place when they're not?
Again, people sometimes are afraid to dip their toes in responsibility because they feel like they're going to get pulled in the deep end. So if you create an environment where people can actually volunteer without getting pulled into the deep end, then they'll be happier and more functional. I mean, every church struggles with those kind of sign-up sheets. Have you heard of sign-up genie?
Sign-up genie?
I almost said diaper genie. Remember those?
Sure. Yeah. Oh my God, I
so sign-up genie is an online way of doing sign-up sheets. So you send them around to the whole church, and when Wendy signs up for coffee hour, you see that date is taken care of. And you don't have to fill in the other dates. So I haven't used it yet, but it's one of my new things I'm thinking, I need to do that.
Well, and that's great because, you know, you got to come into the church and write your name.
Yeah.
And sometimes in the realm of life.
And when you're down here having coffee, you're not looking at each other. So that gets generally ignored. When it doesn't get ignored, though, is when there's no coffee on the table. Sometimes it's good to let things fall through the cracks.
That's what I feel like.
Yeah, you. If people show up and they're used to coffee and refreshments being there, maybe start out, break them in easy, and just have coffee. Or just have nothing. And boy, those lists fill up like crazy. Or there's no flowers in church, and you like flowers in church. Well, why aren't there flowers in church? It's because nobody's signing up for it.
So we have
wait, let me go here first. No. Yep.
I think that one of the biggest problems with the Sunday thing is it gets very fancy.
Yeah.
And nobody wants to try to keep up with what's gone before. So a couple times we've had nobody sign up. Mm-hmm. And Ray will put on the coffee, and I will pull out the cookies and the cheese that's there every week. And that's fine.
Yeah.
You've got a reason to come back here whether you need anything or not. There's stuff there, but it gets really fancy.
Yeah.
That's hard.
Yeah.
It's hard to follow.
Yeah. But I think, so making it clear, this isn't fancy, it just needs to be food.
I should really have to do a lot.
But that's all right. But I really think you having a bailout plan is a bad thing. Yeah, don't pull out cookies and crackers. Let
it fail.
Let it fail and let people realize that it depends on people. Yeah. That's one of the beauties. of this
well,
kind
let,
of...
Let's go without serving your two.
We will survive. Yeah. The sun will come up.
Well, but as a leadership...
Months, we'll see what happens.
Exactly, that's good. I think that's
fine.
We did that one Sunday. We have two services, and so we have a coffee hour in between. And one Sunday, there was nothing. And the chair of the coffee thing said, I'll take care of it. And I'm like,
no, don't.
Yeah.
Let it go.
And the week after,
look at the board that Sunday.
The week after, they all signed up.
Who was it? We all know where the cookies are.
They all signed up that week.
Somebody will go get them.
So it's okay. It's okay to let some things fall through the cracks, too. And that's one of the things about a tighter leadership team, is sometimes you're going to miss some stuff. And things will fall through the cracks. And some things need to be let go of, that you need to let go of. But if you're meeting monthly and you're talking about this stuff and things come up, you can talk about it and discern. The other thing is you can develop other managers for ministry, so the CE person can get somebody to supervise the Sunday school. The deacon coordinator can have four people who help set up communion once a month. So they're different people and they get scheduled, but the coordinator's doing that. You don't need a meeting to do that. All you need is four different people who are willing to do it. And then also, small churches are just better at informally caring for each other. Based on relationships that already exist, and just realize the burden of showing that the church cares is on you to show up when somebody's in the hospital or to do things that are caring, like sending a card, baking cookies.
So if it's not a deacon, officially deacon, but somebody showed up to visit, the church is still reaching out. And commissioning is a word you used yesterday, but like commissioning people that you are a minister, so any action you take can be the church itself reaching out.
And people get I started this thing, it was just harder to keep up with bringing communion to people, so I charged our deacons with bringing communion to shut-ins once a month. So
bringing what?
Communion to shut-ins.
Okay.
So after we have communion on Sunday morning, they go out and serve people communion. Which again, if everybody's a deacon, anybody can do that, you can arrange it, whatever. But they, one time, one of them was bringing the communion to this woman, and the 87-year-old lady says, do you do this because you have to or because you want to? What's your question? She's like, I'm supposed to as a deacon, but I actually want to because I like you. And what I don't have to do is bring you a sandwich and coffee like I do every time I bring the communion, so, and sit with you for a couple hours, you know what I mean? And so it being a deacon actually made it a big hurdle to show that she actually cared and she wasn't just fulfilling a duty, so to speak.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah.
So one of the things that I've heard and experienced is, you know, the dynamic between the two rooms. So we've had people love to come to church.
Yeah.
But they turned coffee hour recruitment.
Oh yeah.
So they're afraid to walk through the transit because they're afraid they're going to get hit.
So this is awesome.
So I was
when I was doing
nominating, I swore to people I will not talk to you about a church position while I'm standing in the room on Sunday.
Yeah. And how awesome is that? Like, so think about getting rid of that. Right. So you have a simplified church structure, and the jobs are all filled. And now coffee hours. That's sort of like what I was talking about. When you're in the church parking lot, you don't want to be talking about who didn't sign up for coffee. You want to be talking about how your kids are doing or what you're, you know, let the relational side of the church do its work. You know?
How about this idea? I remember when I was a deacon, and I, every other month, we would be in charge. We'd make telephone calls. We'd say, hi, Peter. I'm looking for somebody who wants to do coffee. Can you do it? And here are the days that we have available. And we always have that thing filled up.
I do think calling can be a better way to ask people to do things directly.
Why would you say no?
Yeah.
But at the same time, you call people that you can be drawing them in, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you don't call them, you have nothing.
Well, and if people don't come to coffee hour because they don't want to sign up for coffee hour, it's sort of defeating the purpose, right?
It worked.
So it could be you set up, like we separated snacks from coffee. So we have one person who makes the coffee, and then people sign up for snacks. So then you're guaranteed coffee every week, you're just not guaranteed snacks, unless people sign up. Yep.
So we often have potluck lunches or potluck dinners. I personally think it's a great idea to have a potluck coffee hour. Everyone chipping in, bringing a little something, and that can be brought to the congregation as a new idea.
Sure. I think it's a brilliant idea.
We have Cindy that does that.
Yeah, but some people love, that's what we realized, is some people were afraid of our coffee maker. But they were good at baking. So our bakers weren't signing up to bake because they were afraid of the coffee machine. So we separated the two.
Well,
what?
Because somebody goes to the choir, and the choir is pretty loyal about coming. And several of us are choir members.
Yep. We have to get here at 9 o'clock. We're here at 9 o'clock every morning. Coffee hour's not over. We'll call something. I have a really hard time signing up for coffee hours. I don't want to stay back in the floor at 12:30.
Sure.
It's like I'm done.
Yeah.
And so I feel like, oh well, I'm not doing coffee hour, but shoot, every Sunday for 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
But if you were making the coffee, you didn't have to do everything
so
else.
So you
need
to kind of be able to split it with somebody who says, I'll do the
I usually do it. I split it with somebody.
Do you? But
so
but
it's not just me.
Yeah. See, well, and I've done it with people, but usually everybody says, well, you've got to bring stuff and and you're expected to stay and clean up. I'm like, I don't want to clean up. I'm done. I don't want to.
But generally, so this guy who makes our coffee now is, he's always there early for the first service, and he makes the coffee, and it kind of just needs to be the part of the coffee, and then he cleans it up and puts it away. And he offered to do it, and I'm like, that's a lot on one person, but if you want to do it, sure. I mean, so it's okay for people to fill functional gaps in the life of the church. And that's kind of what I hear from your idea. What if, I mean, so every Sunday somebody's coming with a plate of cookies or whatever. Well, some people like are dying to be baking stuff that they don't have family to bake for anymore. So that they're glad to do that. And that's okay. I mean, I don't know. Those are all the minutiae things that you guys would figure out. But these are the kind of things you could end up talking about in a council meeting. And then it could be a congregational idea that we're just going to call it a potluck coffee hour every week. And if you bring it, and there's lots, then we can eat a lot. If nobody brings it, we don't have much. I forgot to clarify that. So I go home to my wife works in a pretty big office area. And I'm like, so how do you guys deal with your refrigerator at work? And she's like,
cleaning up.
We have one person who every month goes in and just cleans out the fridge. And if you left something in there, sorry. Right? So I'm like, that's what we need to do at church. So now we have one person who's in charge of the refrigerator. Every month she comes in and clears it out. And sorry. I've had stuff of mine thrown out. And I'm like, that was my fault. I left it in. You know? So sorry.
Instead of a committee?
No committee is necessary for the refrigerator. We don't need a refrigerator committee.
Well, no, just leaving. Isn't it funny how the kitchen coffee hour, it just never seems to disappear out of the conversation. So let's get to the important part of maybe what all of this was supposed to be. What I want to know is, how are we going to formulate, and who is going to start and be in charge of formulating the new business of the church? How is that going to start? And who's going to do it?
So that's kind of like me going, here you go. You guys, I mean, I gave you a sketch, a rough draft of what a downsized, centralized church government could look like. And I'm hearing you guys say, we're kind of almost there.
I think we are.
So somebody needs to make a motion. And what I would do is go to the congregation first and say, we want to experiment with a downsized, centralized church government. And what we would promise you is that we would bring any major decisions that are potentially controversial to the congregation for vote if anything like that comes up. So you can trust that we'll be extra cautious in this time of experimenting. And we're already going to schedule two meetings, three meetings congregationally a year to get started.
I think the other thing that we need to point out, when we take that to the congregations, in reality, if you read the bylaws right now, we're functioning like this anyhow. And if you would go through the bylaws and see that our bylaws require 64 committee members, you might understand that we cannot support that.
So we're going to do 64.
So what I would suggest is that your church council, your church, current church council, write it up, the motion. The other thing is, with regard to motions, you can do a resolution first. So you say, whereas we're not currently really following our bylaws anymore. Whereas it would take 64 people to fill and live into our current bylaws officially. Whereas we haven't been functioning that way for a long time anyway. Whereas we heard from this strange guy, Doug Bixby, who came and talked to us about it. And whereas it makes a lot of sense to us, we move that for the next 2 years, we try this experiment. And at the end of 2 years, we'll ask ourselves if we think it's working or not. We talked earlier about church plants, so people starting new churches. So imagine, right? That you guys are the core of a church plant. You're just getting this thing going. This parish, whatever, committee who owns the building is letting you use this building. You're going to create an organizing structure. Right? So it's from ground zero. You've never really had any experience with church leadership. Wouldn't you form one body to govern your organization? It just, it's the only thing any church plants do, is a simple church government.
Sorry.
No problem. Nice meeting you.
You can work at it.
So I think if your current church leadership puts together this simple proposal, committing to an experiment for a couple years, and then evaluate it at the end of the couple years. Like I said, I think your church could probably run itself without any structure for a couple years, because you all know what you're doing. So let those entities continue to work. Some things are going to fall through the cracks, but the big things aren't.
Would we have to literally follow our own bylaws as it currently exists, though, and have, do we need our 42 people to vote to allow us to operate in this experimental way? Or do we actually just hold the sort of majority meeting of those who are present after we've posted it and operate outside the bylaws in entirety, like not even have 42 people? I mean, how much do we have to start out?
We spend everything sort of as we ask permission to.
I think that was one of the stumbling blocks of our annual meeting.
Yeah.
That there was a general feeling that came out that we still need to follow the bylaws as far as the voting goes
right.
In your piece.
Yeah.
Right.
But primarily, right, the congregational.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, you vote to suspend, to put the bylaws here, including how many people have to be at a congregational meeting. Like, can that be part of what you do to experiment?
Could it be a straw poll to get us going, or does it have to be a formal vote? You know what I mean?
You've already started an evolutionary process, so it really depends. It seems like the one kind of group that's bigger than the council, or has the deacon board, has sort of an identity. But am I right? Is the deacon board just setting up and serving communion primarily?
Communion and congregational care and worship planning, but nothing that's like governance particularly.
Mm-hmm. And how many deacons are actually like committed?
Well, were they on the?
Who's the chair?
Are we at six?
Eileen is the chair. Or no?
No, no, no.
Tom Pye's
person.
Cheryl's husband.
Yeah. It started out, I believe it says that there are 10 deacons, 10 in the bylaws.
It was voted to make it smaller.
Yes.
We're at six now.
Right, so that's the one thing I saw that seems have an entity unto itself bigger than the church council.
Or I've never sensed that.
Not so it's not a big threat or whatever.
No, I think they love it.
Yeah, I mean, from what I can tell from your annual report and from what I've heard, people are waiting for a resolution. So actually presenting it as a motion. So this thing evolved at my church in Connecticut, and then a local UCC pastor asked me to come and speak to her church. And I went to their church, I met with their executive board once, their congregation once. They had a congregational meeting, voted to do this experiment, and they changed the way they functioned. I was telling Gail last night, this church had had a pattern of every 10 years firing the pastor. Like every 10 years they got whatever, and it just was nasty ends, and it was consistently that way. Well, we met and did this about 6 years into our ministry, and it changed the way they functioned as a church. They had a whole bunch of people serving on their boards who didn't even go to the church. Like, they were a member, sort of, but they really didn't even worship or participate in the church. And when they downsized and simplified, 2 weeks later, her husband came up to me and he said, I want to shake the hand of the man who made my wife's life 1,000 times better. Because it made her life, she just could manage life and ministry a whole lot better with a simple system. And now she's in her, I think, her 21st year of ministry at that church. And it's working. Yeah.
Well, the only thing that, as we alluded to in previous conversation, because we have so many members of our church who travel a lot.
Yeah.
If you reduce, now I was head deacon for several years up until recently, and I had 10 people,
yeah,
myself included.
Yeah.
But at any given deacon's meeting, if we were lucky, we had 5 to 6 people,
yeah,
in attendance.
Yeah.
So if we reduce the size of, well, now Bob says it's 8, and if we reduce the size even to 4 or 5, that means the chance of losing, you know, 2 or 3 of those, you're going to end up with 3 people at a deacon's meeting.
Well, that's what I mean. You don't have a deacon's meeting. Right.
Well, right. I mean, the whole point is, do we even need deacons?
Well, I think the thing that we're talking about,
the deacon coordinator could use those 6 people, 4 people maybe, to set up and serve communion.
Right.
Then they don't even need a meeting.
It's the same thing that I was saying for our last council meeting is, hey, you might be the chair of this committee or head of the deacons,
yeah,
but if you can't be there because you're traveling or something, please make sure that somebody from the deacons on your list is there to support the meeting.
Yeah.
And I think that's what the coordinator can do.
Yeah.
Is have somebody represent that mission,
yeah,
or that function.
Yeah.
And the bigger opportunity ultimately is that if everybody in the church is deacon, the coordinator can actually ask almost anybody to be doing that. There might be a few people that really love doing communion and are willing to, like, pour the juice with a little squirter or whatever, you know, but...
You know, you could even in the proposal, so in the proposal, you say, we're going to suspend, and I don't know, again, I'm not a lawyer, and I heard there was, like, question if we're going to be. That first paragraph is the most important in the polity question. So your object of faith, your faith, and your polity. It's Article 1 and 2, your name and your object, faith, and polity, that are the most important. Then 3, membership is important. Admission, sure. Reception, fine. Duties, fine. Termination.
I think when you get into pages 5, 6, 7, 8, where it's defining each committee member and how many members have to be,
yep,
on those committee members, that's where we're really falling apart.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So all the way through page 4, say, moderator, vice moderator. So it would be basically taking 5 through, you know, you can look at them,
yeah,
and just temporarily suspend them with and add some extra caution. Say, we'll bring anything potentially controversial to the congregation, including any expenditure over, and what's that amount? Just promise them you're not